1 month ago, roughly. Okay, recording, yeah. 1 month ago at the Outlier conference, which is a data visualization conference. So I focused more on the visuals than on the coding part. And now I present an extended version where we will also have a lot more code and a few more slides in here. So yeah, last time I needed to rush through a bit because this was limited to 20 minutes, but I still don't want to take too much of your time. And I'm happy to discuss everything ggplot related and my slide related afterwards. Okay. Now I need to find my controls. Here we go. Okay. Yeah, so first I shared the links to the repository. It's the same as for the Outlier conference and to the new slides also in the chat. If you want to follow along, you can of course also download them later. And thanks for the nice introduction, Raul, and thanks for having me. And this was very welcoming and warm words. Thanks so much. I will also show other nice visualization from other people. But yeah, it's actually really interesting what you can now achieve in R. And we see new ways of solving issues nearly every week in ggplot and in R in general. So I'm a scientist by training and a data viz designer by heart. I will already mention it, maybe also a bit of my background. So I'm using R for quite a while. So these packages now mainly, most of them from the tidyverse, similar to Raul, it was 12, 13 years ago that I touched R for the first time, but we rushed through. I didn't follow any of the codes really. It was more about stats output and really into R. And then I got 2011, where I used mostly base R and linear modeling and base R plotting. And in 2016, during my PhD, in the beginning of my PhD at the ISW, I discovered ggplot2 and then shortly after that, the rest of the tidyverse and fell in love. And yeah, since then did almost everything in R. So I guess 99% of my work, no matter if scientific or client work or personal stuff, is in R, and 95% in ggplot2. And the other 5% are then also plotting libraries from R, which make interactive visualizations such as eCharts or Plotly. Since 2019, I started using ggplot for everything and on a daily basis. And since last year, I'm also freelancing with ggplot2. I design visualizations, I improve ggplots, I also analyze a bit, and I give workshops. There are two images missing. I guess they are too big. I hope they're in the PDFs. Yeah, this is these are some example works from my scientific work. Here are some example work from some client projects, and all of these are done 100% in ggplot. There's no after processing, no post editing. And here are some personal projects, mostly contribution to challenges. And yeah, what's ggplot2 actually? ggplot2 is a system, or you can also say an R package, for declaratively creating graphics based on the grammar of graphics, which is a theory or theoretical thing. We will not go much into this, but the idea is not to talk about so much about chart types, but more about building your plot step by step by adding geometries and adding scales and things like this. You might be familiar to it if you used ggplot before. And basically, Hadley Wickham translated this grammar of graphics, this theory, into something which you can program. And also other tools use this, for example, Vega. And if you look for ggplot2 in a simple Google image search, you will most likely find these typical grayscaled ggplot, which are the common thing of ggplot and the default settings. And also you see same colors over here. You can then click on beautiful ggplot. It's directly suggested. And if you go there, you will still find some grayish, but most people don't use the gray background anymore. But still these plots here, this is my tutorial actually. Most of these plots are not that advanced. This one is a great tutorial here. And sometimes, you might ask yourself, how can I learn how to build these things? And I will hopefully show you a few tricks how to do that and where to search for resources and inspiration. So first, this is the grayish ggplot. So this is a simple plot you can create with two lines of codes. So first you need to specify a data, then the X and the Y variables, and then the geometry, which are points here. And we add some transparency with the alpha. to the points to avoid overplotting or to make visible that there are several plots on top of each other. With a bit more code, you can make it look like that. So add a bit of color, make it a white background, add some labels and stuff. And how do we do that? So we, in the GM point or also in the ggplot call, this here doesn't matter. We can specify some aesthetics here, the color, and we map this to the body mass. Then we get this legend for free. And here I use directly custom colors because I'm not a very big fan of the default colors, which are light blue to dark blue. And I don't think they are very useful. And here I use one of my favorite color packages, the Skyco package by Thomas Lynn Patterson, and one of the palettes. And direction just means make the dark values the highest, which is a good practice if you have a light background. Afterwards, I also played around a bit with the scale X and the scale Y to make it a nicer spacing. So with the breaks and the limits, and you might notice here that I specified the breaks like this. This is not ggplot related. This is pure R tricks, which I learned from Mike, cool but useless, who did this great ggplot packages. Have a look. And yeah, this is an easier way than writing the sequence thing for sometimes. So here I would have a hard time to figure out how I need to write this, but for simple steps, I now like to use this. For the sequence, if you want to write it the same way, you could also print the numbers from 5 to 9 and multiply them by 2 times 5, which would end up with the same sequence here. So to shorten that, you can use something like this. And then I set the limits to make sure that the outer values are also shown. And the custom labels, so we can add a title, a subtitle, a caption, the X and Y labels, and also the legend title, which we can change here in the labs, which is a better practice, but you could also make it an argument of the scale color function. You might have noticed that nothing of this is related to the background. So my routine usually is not to apply the theme to the ggplot, but set it globally. But you can also add it with a plus sign, as you might know. So you can change the global theme settings, which you need to do before you plot the plot with a theme set. And then you use whatever theme you want to use, one of the defaults or one of the many extension packages. You can set the base size, which is the font size, the overall, which will be scaled. So it's not all 12, but this is a multiple of 12, and this is a multiple of 12. And you can change all the text with the argument base family. So you don't need to manually set them in the theme. You can just say, okay, all of my text labels should be open sans. And afterwards, if you still want to change something of this default theme here to minimal, you can also modify the plot elements globally. So again, first run this and then plot your plots with a theme update. And then here I specified everything I changed here, for example. So this is usually how my codes always start, with a theme set and then a long theme update. I often start also with a theme void, depending what I'm doing. So theme void draws nothing, and then I can decide on my own what I want to add. I know several people are doing this, especially the people doing more fancy, colorful stuff where we don't care so much about access text or set them on our own. So here I modify the ticks length. I always remove the minor panel grid because I think it's not useful without any labels, and some styling of the labels. Still, you could come up with some plots. So this is penguin data, actually, Palmer penguins by Alison Hurst, which is a nice data set to play around with. And this was part of a Tidy Tuesday challenge. And then people came up with these plots and some others. And it's still a long way to go from a white, nicely gridded plot with some title to something like this. So we have many things. Some are related to design and data viz, so color choice and how do I design things, but also how do I do it in a coding way? So how do I change the colors? How can I change the design of the legend or style some text, add annotations, or draw penguins, for example. And this is kind of, maybe you know this here, how to draw an all. So if you have this gray one, cool, two lines of ggplot, but to make it to make it a bit more, you might end up with a lot of more lines of code. But fortunately, it's not pure magic. It's code, and people share it. So at least for Tidy Tuesday, but in the whole R community, it's good practice to share your code on likely on GitHub. And these are contributions, as mentioned, by Laura, Joe, and Georgios. And all of them, when they share these visualizations on Twitter, they also share their code. So you can go there, have a look at the code, learn it from it, get in touch with new packages and stuff, and yeah, learn from that. That's what I usually do, and many others as well who follow the Tidy Tuesday. So what's Tidy Tuesday, actually? Tidy Tuesday is a social project, a weekly data project tailored to R, but we now, for example, I'm running a local Tidy Tuesday meeting where now people also using Python for that. But actually initiated was by the R4DS online learning community, which is a Slack learning community mostly targeted at the R4 Data Science book by Hadley Wickham. So it's basically a book club. You can work through the chapters on your own speed and then ask questions for the community. And there are mentors who are going to answer these questions. And they initiated this Tidy Tuesday project, which you can follow on Twitter with the hashtag Tidy Tuesday. And so these are some citations from an article which was published last year, I guess. Tidy Tuesday is great. So you can participate, but even if you don't have enough time, you can just follow it and get inspired by either the design or the packages and the codes that the people use. And also, it's kind of like a choose your own adventure game. So we see many interesting stuff which are maybe not helpful for your usual communication of data or what you don't would spend on 8 hours or 16 hours to draw some penguins. But it's something really weird or something really impressive and artsy beyond traditional data visualizations that you can do with ggplot and pure code without post-editing these plots. Yeah. One of the famous and very nice drawings by Alison Horst, and I really like this one. So if I share these ggplots, it might look like, yeah, Cedric is doing crazy stuff here, but without all these package and with all these codes and stuff, I wouldn't be able to do this. So I want to share with you now some plots that have been done purely in R with a link to the package so that you might learn about new packages that you can use for ggplot and also the great work, the design work. So first of all, again, the my penguin contribution here. So there are already three packages involved mainly. There are some more, but it's the ggdist, the ggtext, and the patchwork package. All of them I will cover on the slides later in a bit more detail. You can build very nice tree diagrams and networks like this example by Thorsten with the ggraph the ggraph package. You can build tree maps by Yobani with the tree mapify package. You can do waffle plots like this one by Anna with the waffle package. You could also make now bump charts. This is a quite new package with the ggbump package by David. So this is one example from the GitHub page, from the vignette. Also stream graphs, also a package from David with the ggstream package. That's wrong here. You can make these moon charts with the ggGibbers package. You can geofacets, so similar to usual facets that display your data in a grid subset of your data. You can make also geofacets. So here this shows Europe. This is a contribution by Jack and with the geofacet package. Of course, you can make beautiful maps with SF and many more packages targeted to spatial data. For example, the cartogram package where you can distort the area based on a variable. And you can draw things like penguins mentioned now several times already with the ggforce package by Georgios. Even do tables. I mean, there are packages to do tables, but this was also a nice challenge to do. And I did one as well in ggplot, but now, especially now, we have a nice package called GT and Reactable for interactive tables. So yeah, if you want to try it, you can do it. I'm not saying that this is the most efficient way. Or pixel art, or even generative art like this one by Thomas Lynn Patterson. So many, many things you can do. And again, I want to highlight that these are all done 100% with R. I mean, some other codes in the background, but yeah, ggsafe, and that's it. One of my things I always show in my ggplot workshops is the example by the BBC, because I found it really impressive back then when I found this in 2018, I guess, that the BBC is doing many of their static graphs or all of their static graphs with ggplot, and also in a very nice design. So they came up with their own package for consistent theming, and that's what they write about it. At the BBC data team, we have developed this package to make the process of creating publication-ready graphics in our in-house style using the ggplot library a more reproducible process. So this is really the nice thing as well. So why should I care about that I don't need to post-edit it? Yeah, the nice thing is if you want to do it again with updated data, you want to change the color for some other reason, the background or stuff. Sure, you can do this in Illustrator as well, but you can also run your code again. And especially the ggplot code, if you're not using many, many extension packages, is unlikely to break any soon, which I wouldn't say about my general R codes, where I fear with every update that something might break with ggplot. Yeah, at least they usually depreciate your things and give you a notification that you might want to update your code. In preparation for the talk I gave at the conference, I did this plot where I wanted to see which geoms and stats I used the most in my ggplot. So I scraped data from my own scripts from 2019 and 2020. And here I compared the use. So green means I use them more, and orange means I use them less. And this is kind of the frequency, how often per script. So you can see that I used GM text in 2020 roughly 2.3 times per script, which is attributed that I'm using more and more annotations, direct labeling like these, to make data visualizations that are easier to digest, which are easier to understand, to follow, and nicer to look at. So what peeks out here is that really the text labels are all increasing, and you can see already that there are many, many functions that are related to text, and not all of them are from ggplot itself. So the golden ones are from extension packages. And I want now to highlight two of these packages for annotations, because I think these are important, and in especially, I mean, also back then, but comes more and more important now, and also in for scientific plotting and stuff, that we add annotations to make it easier to understand and to see what to focus on. So these two packages are ggtext and ggforce, and we will start with ggtext. GTText is a package developed by Klaus Wilke. It's a package that improves the text rendering support in ggplot. And if you have worked with text in ggplot, you know that it's pretty tedious to change your fonts or to make labels that have different colors or have different stylings. And the ggtext solves all these issues. Not the font, but the styling. For the fonts, now we have, as a side note, the system fonts package and the reg package, which work, at least for me, very great. The extra font package and the show text package are others that can be used to import fonts, but actually, they are not working that as good for me as the new one, the system fonts package. But back to ggtext. Ggtext comes with two or three new geoms and two new elements. So I didn't spend much time on it, or I didn't even mention it when I talked about updating your theme. So if you want to update, for example, your axis title, you need to refer to an element theme, because this is to an element text, because this is a text element in your theme. And there are three of these, or strict four. So there's element text, there's element rect, and there's element line, and then there's element blank to draw nothing. And the ggtext package adds two. The first one is element markdown, which allows you to format text elements such as titles, captions, access text, strip text, legend text, and so on. And so this is one of this is the plot I showed you before, the stylized, customized ggplot. And as a biologist, I'm not very happy about having the genus name in non-italic. And this is something which was, yeah, usually would be post-editing. The other solution would be to make this a make this two text labels and then add this in italic or something, but there's no option to style it like this. And with the ggtext, you can do it. And I will show you how. This uses Markdown or HTML encodings or syntax. And here I use the Markdown way. So as the name says, element Markdown, and Markdown means one asterisk around the name is italic and two makes it bold. This is just as an example here. So we can make parts of some strings bold and italic. And then to make this work, you need to override the default element text by element markdown, which says like, okay, turn this markdown text into something stylized. If you don't add this, you will see the stars here. But you can also use HTML. You would still use the element markdown, so there's no element HTML, but you can use HTML code as well in your string. For example, you could now make this italic and change the color by using the HTML tag I for italic, emphasized, and then the style, and then is the argument color, and then the hex code or the name of the color. And then you need to close it. So if you're not used to HTML, I wasn't that much before as well, but now I know a lot about HTML thanks to ggtext and my blog. So yeah, this will turn out then like this. And you could even do much more. So you can change the font size, the font family, the line height, and you could even add some images, which doesn't work for me on a Windows machine because of CURL, the CURL package, which has a bug and is used in the ggtext package, but some of you maybe can use it. For me, it looks like this. What's nice about this image tag actually is that you can use images then as text labels. For example, have a look at the ggtext vignette. He's showing an example for that. So for example, I use this here to change the font color and font face here of the main characters of the Serious Friends. So this is again a contribution to Tidy Tuesday, where I just had a look at partners with main characters of Friends, how often they appeared throughout the series. And as you know, if you have watched Friends, they also are partners together. So two main characters. So this meant I had to style these in different ways, making them bold and colored for all of these. And this is how it looks like in the code. And now I want to spend a minute or two on showing you how you can do this in ggplot without writing all of them by hand. One R, not in ggplot. So first I set up a tibble. Or a data frame where I have two columns, which are called key and color. So the first is a vector of all the names of the main characters. If there are two main characters as partners, then also of them because they have a slightly different color, and then all of them get the color matched. So this tibble looks like this, now reduced to three to illustrate it. So we have the key and then the responding color here. And now I write joined with the data frame friends, which I prepared from the Tidy Tuesday source. We will not have a look at it here because I just will show you how it looks afterwards. So we have some key column in the DF friends as well, which I extracted from all the partners I mutated before. So in the original DF friends data frame, there's also a column called partners for all of them. See, this is not only Chandler, it's with Janice, but here it's the same. And then for each episode, and then some more information determining the height of these rectangles. And then I do a mutate to add the HTML tags to these with a mutate if else. And this is a longer chunk of code, and we will walk through it step by step. So first the mutate. if I create a, I can create new columns. So I create a new column partners, which will be added here. Which is not true, I realize now, because we had a partners before, which will overwrite the old partners. Sorry for that. I didn't pay close attention here, which will overwrite it, but it's okay to empty it here. And yeah, now we are back here. And then we add an if else statement and say, if the key is the same as the partners, then the first thing applies, the true, otherwise the false, which is the case for Ross and Rachel, both are main characters. So this was the same as this. And then I glue, you can also use the paste function, the base paste function. And then I put the HTML tag around this by combining the value in the color column and the string in the key column, which will end up like this. So both names are colored and bold. Note the bold tag for the HTML code. Otherwise, so for Chandler and Ross with Carol and Janice, I use the string replace function from the string R package. So in the partners string, replace the key. So this is Ross and Chandler, and put around these this HTML color. And then this will be unchanged, but it will, instead of having only Ross and Chandler, we'll add this with the whole HTML code. And this way I can quickly add with a few lines and a small tibble all this without going through each of these names and each episode to add these HTML tags to make it colorful. The other things we have in the gg-text package is the geom-rich text, which is basically the same as the element markdown, but as a geom. So if you want to add annotations, you can format them, you can color them. Here I illustrated with two different fonts or font families, one bold, one italic, and different colors here. And you can even rotate them. That's kind of important to Klaus, at least I figured out on the vignette. Then there's another element as mentioned, or two, but both behave the same. So element text box and element text box simple. Usually you use element text box simple, which has some defaults, which element text box doesn't have. With this, you can override again element text parts in your theme. So we can make text boxes for the caption and the title, for example. The nice thing is with the element text stop that has a word wrapping. So if you have a very long title or especially a very long subtitle with a long description, which is a good thing to explain what you are showing on your graph, you don't want to line break, do the line breaks on your own manually, but you can use then element text box to do so. And similarly, there's the geom text box, which also has formatted word wrapping, and you can place it inside your panel. So it's a geom. And another example where I used it for here, the font family, font size, the font face, and the line height were changed this way. And these were also generated with a mutate out of the data, filling in the numbers and so on. Another example, I will talk about this a bit later as well again, but this is also a whole text box where I use geom text box and geom rich text. So geom rich text for these annotations and geom text box to have the line breaks. You can do also a bit more. So you can also have a custom element text box highlight, for example. So this is adapted from Stack Overflow answer from Klaus. And you will find it in my tutorial as well. So you can highlight or change, for example, facet names of only one facet. Okay. And the next one is ggforce, which is a large toolbox of many great stuff and weird stuff, which adds missing functionality to ggplot2. It's developed by Thomas Lynn Patterson. And this is just a few examples of many, many things you can do with it. So I always wanted to use this one, but never have. You can add a zoom facet to your plot to zoom in. You can make, I use them here very often, some Zener plots to show raw data distributions, Voronoi diagrams, and some other stuff. And first I want to highlight not the text stuff, but this B-spline function, which is, yeah, interesting. So back to the penguins again, by Gorgias. So he used actually B-spline to build these. And I had a look yesterday evening how he did that. And I always wanted to, and now this was a good reason to do so. And it's really interesting that, so this is how this behaves. So basically he, I assume, did draw them first and then translated to a data frame. And these are the single parts. And then he put them all on top of each other. And if you now color them correctly, you will already see that these might be penguins. And the final result would look like this. And then he added also some eyes and other details. Yeah, so you can even draw in ggplot if you like to. Okay, back to text labels. There's also this very nice geomark family, which adds these text labels, which are, I think, a very nice, yeah, nice design. And you can also add a lot more. If you look into the vignette packages by Thomas Lynn Patterson, are always full of all the options you want to have. They are already in. So every time I ask, like, oh, this would be cool, it's already in there. So first, what can you do with this? It's a family, as mentioned. So there are several of these geomark functions. Here, for example, the geomark ellipsoid. And you, in the aesthetics, you can specify the groups and also the label for the annotations. And then it will, by default, draw these circles around the data with a bit of spacing. So this is not a cluster analysis or something like that. This is just for annotation. And it will by default add this, but you can change basically everything. You can turn off these artsy thing here. You can change the gap, make it larger or no gap at all. And you can even add descriptions and much more. You can also only highlight a single group or several groups. So you can also filter within. And this is something what I mentioned. There's already a filter argument in there that you can say filter species gen 2. So you don't need to filter your data manually and put it in the geom, but you can do it in the aesthetics because Thomas built it in. And there are three more. So there's the geomark hull, circle, and rect, depending on what you need. So there, I saw a funny example building a map with these. So for every use case, there's something. And you can even turn off the color of this mark and just use the labels, for example, what I did. This is first Jake's example. Sorry for that. So this is one of the COVID charts, and Jake added some direct labels to the original. And this is the geomark circle, highlighting different points. And then you can see that you have the label, but you can also add a description by default, which is also styled differently by default. Still, you can see a bit of problems or might want to make several iterations with it play around a bit with the spacing, because it's not always using the optimal way of putting your annotation. So here it's a bit difficult to see, or here it's crossing the line, for example, here as well. Preferably, it would be here, and this would be a bit more here or here. So there's no logic inside to repel it from every GM you have there. It will just point towards the data you specify. And here I just used the labels, so I turned off the geometry of the highlights, so the hull or the ellipsoid or rectangle or circle, and I just used the labels to annotate these bars here. And that's how you could do it. So with expand unit, you need a tiny expansion, otherwise it will not draw anything. And then you can turn off the concap. So there are many, many arguments you can go through, and you can really customize it as you like. Okay, and now I want to go through three other extension packages, which is the ggdist and first the ggdist, which is a nice set of uncertainty and distribution chart types or geoms. And here's the full list from the vignette. So you can see you can make dot plots. Often they come with these additional slab to show confidence intervals or make something like a box plot. There's these nice interval stripes, the CD or CCDF intervals, and also half eyes and eyes for violin plots. A lot of great stuff here. I'm mostly using the half eye, the interval, and the dots thing, and some examples here. This is another Tidy Tuesday visualization I did, showing ratings of coffee beans, and I decided to draw each bean visually on a dot plot, and then added with these intervals, I added the full gradient of 25, 50, 95, and 100% of the voting range. And then, as you can see, yeah, some other labels highlighting the median, the lowest value, and the country. And these kind of additional stripes, so here they are very thin and small design thing, but they can be very useful to summarize distributions or outcomes of your model. So closer look here, this is the stat dots, this is the stat interval, and then also some GM text and GM point to add these. Another example, this is a bit older from 2019, the range of daily temperatures in Berlin per month for 18 years. And this is the stat interval again, and I added the half eye to it with the showing the median, which adds another information to this distribution or summary. The next one is the ggGibbous package. This is drawing moon charts in ggplot. So first, what are moon charts? Circular part to hole charts can also be called. So there's this paper by Robert Cossara, and he's doing great data visualization stuff. And he also has a very, very neat YouTube channel if you want to learn a bit more about theory and how to make nice charts or what to have a look for. And there was kind of like a study about testing different part to whole designs. So to get a bit like the discussion, is the pie chart useful or not? And this is the error people made or the sign error to estimate how much of the area is filled blue. And as you can see, so these are the moon charts. They perform equally or even better than pie charts. They are just be useful for two categories, but also the pie chart should preferably be used for two or three charts categories only. And in the response time, these are even easier to guess. And you have seen this chart before in the showcase. And I think they can make a very nice use if you don't need to read the exact proportions, but the overall pattern. So the striking thing here, so this is about slaves in the US showing as a line graph the black population per area. So for the southern states here, the upper line, and for all the others on the lower line. And within each dot for each decade, the proportion of free black persons versus enslaved black persons. And yeah, I mean, it becomes clearly obvious that the upper line, which are much more black persons, also are, most of them are enslaved, while here we had still more than a half here, but at least lots more yellow than here. And then obviously the nice thing, 1870s, with a full yellow for both. Another example from the vignette. So this, you can use this also to show pattern on a map, for example, or use in a table instead of numbers showing ratios. So I think they are very neat. And here they played also around with the size of the moon itself, which then maps to the number of observations. Last but not least, the ggStream package to make stream plots by David Sjösbeck. These are examples from his GitHub page. I think it's not on CRAN yet. You need to install it from GitHub. I'm not sure. So these are stream graphs. So we can, if you like, or better not, discuss how useful they are or not. But they are very common and very trendy currently. And sometimes they work good, sometimes they were not that good. As always, it depends on what you want to highlight. So if you want to highlight the rise of action, it definitely works. If you want to highlight the decrease of comedy and drama, it definitely works. It doesn't work if you want to figure out how much the numbers change from here to here. But this is not the purpose of this chart. And just to illustrate what you can do with this, you can play around with the bandwidth. One of the arguments, you can also add these, how do you call it, extra span, extra spans to make it look less rectangular. And you've seen this example as well. I used an early version of this package, and I added, actually he did it because he liked it in mine, so I actually manipulated the data to end to add these trailing ends because it didn't look that nice with cutted ones. Again, we can discuss about, so stream graphs have a lot of interpolation and stuff, so this is obviously not useful, having containing useful information. This is a design purpose, but also here it will kind of like fit a line here, so it's also not, as mentioned, not it's more for comparison in general than comparing actual numbers. And going back, you can also turn it off a bit. I tried this in my version as well. So you have the option to also highlight that this is just extrapolated, or I mean, a design thing. It's not even extrapolated. Okay. And the last part, do I still have time? Is about the base ggplot package. I just keep talking until Raoul says something. Okay.
Keep talking, keep talking.
Okay. So I want to highlight a few things you can change with ggplot2 or within the base package without using any of the extension packages. So maybe you say like, yeah, okay, stream graphs, moon charts, trendy stuff, but not useful for me. I just want to have my scatter plot, and that's totally fine. But still, you can, there are several things you can improve from a design perspective, but also in an easy way from the coding side you might just never think about or didn't know about. And oops, where's my title? This is again my our latest plot from the Penguin data, now with the custom design, custom labels, and also added now the geomark functionality here with the annotations. There we go. And one of the things that bothered me a lot when I started using ggplot more and more was that the titles are not left aligned, which might be now look a bit picky in this case, but still it bothers me, but I'm a perfectionist. It's totally fine if you say I don't care here, but if you get very, very long labels, which are like categories on a bar chart, which you don't want to rotate, which is good, then you get an ugly spacing here. And usually good routine is that you left align your title. So you could also then say, okay, I put it in the middle, but then it looks a bit lost. And the only way to deal with this was basically putting a negative horizontal justification and then play around with the right justification. And once you change the aspect ratio, the width of the plot a bit, it will be cutted. And now there is a way to do this. So first you might want to change the horizontal justification. So this is something you add to the existing plot here. This is the theme call. And then we address the plot title and the element, it's of element text, or now it's actually element markdown, sorry for that. And you put the horizontal justification to zero, and it will end up like this because this justification is by default to the panel. The panel means the plotting area. So everything inside, we don't have a rectangle here, but everything inside here. So this is the panel, and this full white area is the plot. And if you change that to plot, it's a very recent change last year in ggplot version 3. It will justify it to the left of your plot, not of the panel. Note that it will also justify the subtitle because it doesn't make sense to have them justified in different ways. Well, if you like so, then you need to play around with the adjust argument. And you can do the same with the caption. Here it makes sense to make it an own theme element, so, or theme call with plot caption position, and then the same applies plot or panel. And this is a larger gap. And if you don't like that, that's basically what I meant. If you have very long title here, and you can do it like this now. One of the things which are very, well, what's very nice about ggplot is that you get these legends for free, and I think they are often quite useful. I actually don't really like their appearance, and I also don't like that much that they're on the right hand, more from a data viz design part, but again, depends also when you want to use it. I think in many fields, it's also common that you look at the right hand to see the legend. I think in a general thing, and also considering that people are more and more using mobile, it might be a good idea to put the legend on the top. And you can, well, it's also wrong. Damn, sorry, should be top. Wow. Okay, so the default is right, and you can set it to the top, to the bottom, to the left, and also to any point inside your panel. And speaking of mobile, the good thing is if you have very, very long graphs, people will see first your legend and then know what this is about. And also it removes the white space here, so you can have the full width of a mobile screen here. Yeah, and notice that by default, if you write top or bottom here, it will also rotate your legend by default. So you don't need to take care of it, that you get a horizontal legend and the labels like this. ggplot will take care of that. Still, I find it a bit crowded. There's a lot of white space here and the labels are close together. So we can improve that with something called the guide color bar. And you can address that with the guides. So again, something you add to your ggplot. You have your ggplot plus guides, and then you address which aesthetic, which mapping you want to address. So here it's color. And then there are several of these guides. There's guide color bar, there's guide legend, there's guide color steps, and some more. And within these, you can then specify different other things, which I will show you now. So you can, for example, move the title to the top and just the horizontal justification in the center. You can increase the bar width, and you can decrease or increase the bar height. And so you get add a bit more spacing, you use the space a bit more, and I think the title on top looks way better than having it on the left. So this is something, it took me years to remember by heart. Now I can write it by heart because I wrote it like, I don't know, 100 to 500 times, but I need to look it up often. But I mean, you can keep a snippet or have a look in the R-help in the guides function to have a look. And there are many more settings you can use here. If you have a discrete legend, you can also change the bar width and bar height of each of the lines or the rectangles that are drawn. So it's very powerful. Another thing which is a common question on Stack Overflow and so on is, for some people, is that by default, ggplot adds some expansion to your plot, which means that if you have an origin of 0, 0, it will be not in the corner, but added a bit above, which is nice if you have line graphs, for example, that drop down to 0, that they are not hidden behind the outline of your panel. But some people get annoyed by that. And you can easily do that by, so this is the default, the expansion is true, and you can just set expand false, and then it starts in the corner. Some geeky details here, but this is something which is also useful in other terms. And for me, at least, as mentioned, a perfectionist, I can't unsee it anymore, but yeah. So Klaus was tweeting 2018 about a thing that he added to the ggplot functionality, which is the clip equals off. And this is one example which looked terrible in his opinion. And it took me a long time to figure out what this is about, and actually I need his help. So this is the improved version. And if you still can't spot it, it's fine. No one spotted it actually. So what is this about? And what this is actually about is that by default, the clipping is on, which means that everything outside of the panel area, which belongs to the panel, will be clipped, which results in something like this. So the outline, the panel outline border is actually thicker. So we specified something like 0.5, but because of the clipping, it will only show 0.2. And because the thicks are outside, they will be drawn in the same or in the correct thickness. And by setting clipping off, it will perfectly align. So this is super nerdy, I agree. But it's useful if you want to draw outside of your plot area, which you will likely do if you're now using more direct annotations because it's good practice. You will end up with something like this. And there are two ways to deal with this, obviously. We can expand the X range here, the maximum, but then we would have unneeded labels, for example, but you could obviously do this. Or you could just simply set clip off and then add a bit of margin to the white space. So assume this would be a very long text explaining something. We don't want to have a line here all the way. This is how you can use clip off. So which basically means you can, as a fixed point, it's still on the panel, but you can make a lot outside the panel, which is used in many of these more ambitious ggplots for Tidy Tuesday and so on, that we add a lot of stuff to the panel, which is not actually the panel. So we're using geoms to add annotations and stuff, additional legends. Speaking about the margin. So if you're including your plot in a report or something, this might not bother you, but if you want to share your plot alone, then you might want to consider to add a bit of spacing to the margin, a bit of white space. So the default is this, don't worry about this base size you have seen in the theme update. So this is some internal thing, which then, as mentioned, is multiples of the base size are then used for different things in the ggplot, for example, the text, but also for the margin. As you can see, it's close here. And if you get very long labels, you might have already have experienced that. So if this would be like 100,000, you would only see 100 here. And you can easily override it by theme plot margin and then margin and then specifying the top, right, bottom, and left. So now I need to think about it. And the way to remember it, it's trouble. So the margin brings you in trouble, top, right, bottom, left. Okay, and the last thing is that you can, even without any extension packages, you can add images to your plot. So there are many packages or several packages out there to add images. Some work better, some not that as good. It also depends on your use case, on the operating system you are working on, and so on. And this is not so intuitive, but you can work with it with the custom thing, which is inside ggplot too. What you do is you need with magic, you read in however you do it, you can directly read in an image from Alison Hoare's GitHub repository. You don't even need to download it. We save this in an object called PNG. Then we turn this in something which is called a raster crop, which is also again something more internal of ggplot with the grid library, which turns this in a so-called grop we can then add on top of our ggplot. And then we add to our ggplot the annotation underscore custom function with the image object. And then you specify y min, y max, x min, and x max. And this is where it gets a bit strange because it will always scale the image. So it will not distort the image, which is a good thing. Some packages do that and it's not always what you want, but it will also not always fill it. So depending on which is wider or higher, you might play around with these values. So if you would now map it to these numbers, it would not fit. It's also not relative to the plot, but it's absolute to the plot, to the X and Y, which might be also not helpful. So the cow plot, for example, solves this, where you specify like the middle point or the corner of your image, and it's going from 0 to 1 and 0 to 1. So you can move it around like this. And then you specify the size of the image with another argument. So the cow plot packages also helps you. But if you want to quickly add one image, one logo, you can also use the annotation custom. Then you don't rely on any dependencies here or other dependencies. Finally, Patchwork, which is package, calls themselves the composer of ggplots. Again, a package by Thomas Lynn Patterson, which was not listed in my GM collection because it's not a GM, because it's composing ggplots, and it's so great, you need to know about it if you don't know yet. I mentioned kowplot, so you can do this with kowplot as well. You can do this with the egg package. You can do it also with the grid package with forming grobs and then putting them together. But patchwork is super easy. Again, an illustration by Alison Horst. And it's really as easy as shown here. So this Leonardo here or whatsoever has a plan how to put his artwork up here. And it's P1 plus P2 in parentheses divided by P3. And that's exactly what comes out here. So these are nested together. So P1 plus P2 next to each other. And divided means below that. And because this is nested below both of them, put the third one. So let's see a bit of code here, but the code was already on this image. So this is the final plot you know now. I made a rain cloud plot, a second one, as in the original contribution to Tidy Tuesday. And also here, something went wrong. See here, I didn't use element markdown. There are still the asterisks around it. And we can say P1 divided by P2 in case we want to have it below. We would say plus if you want to have it next to each other horizontally. And then there's some other functions you can add. There's plot annotations to add labels, and there's a plot layout where you can specify the width and the height and some other things. And here I just say that this should be bigger than this one. So this is only 2/3 of this. I scaled it here already as this. But by default, it would fill the same. And this is what comes out here. So it's really, if you just would run this, it would be kind of like 50-50. And with the plot layout, I can control which one is bigger. And it's pretty advanced. You can specify it still with these dividers, plus signs, or also with these vertical lines. But you can also specify some more advanced grids by setting a grid of AA and spaces and BB, and then we'll put the plot there. Have a look in the vignette. It's pretty cool. And you can also nest them and then apply layouts and annotations to nested things. And one example, it's not really that advanced, but just to illustrate here that this is not one ggplot, but also I didn't paste it together afterwards. I did it in R. This is how it looked like in theme. Which theme is this? I don't know. Black and white, maybe? No. But you see here that this is actually a geofacet. It will fill in here the other ones. We don't care about it. And these are actually 4 geofacets with titles here, but no titles here. And this one is an old plot where I added, as mentioned, with ggtext, different geom text boxes and points to build the legend. And then you can add this with patchwork on the left-hand legend, then main, then nested these 3 things on top of each other. And then with the plot layout, I say, okay, this is the main plot, and this should be relative roughly 1/3, and this should be relative roughly 1/3, and that's the final product. Okay, so that's kind of the summary. I don't want to go through all of this. You can have a look in the slides. So this is basically the summary of how to manipulate text and move it to the left, how to build your custom legend, add annotations with ggforce, use patchwork to combine things. Here I use the ggdist half I function to build this rain cloud plots. I will post a blog post soon on this because I had a discussion a few days ago about that. So many things, but basically, in the end, I don't know, 10 lines of code. Of course, there are some more great resources. The ggplot 2 book, it's now an open access book you can find online, the 3rd version. It's work in progress currently. And of course, you can also buy then soon the new version edition, but also the 2nd edition. But I would wait for the 3rd one, obviously. And then there's one of many good things, but this is really outstanding, the R Graph Gallery by Jan Holtz. There's also a Python version and a Flourish version of this, so other tools to draw graphs. And yeah, it comes with so much more. So if you click on these plots, it will tell you not only how to write code and which packages to use and alternatives, but it will also point you towards what are these chart types good for, what are they bad, or how you can deal with some things. also articles about how to deal with overplotting, for example. And if you're going to the articles, you can again click on the code button and will reveal the code of the images inside the articles, which are done in ggplot as well. So there's a lot of hidden code in here as well, and also a lot of good theoretical stuff. Yeah, I have a blog as well. I'm not blogging so regularly, but from time to time. You can find all the codes of this talk, but also from the challenges, Tidy Tuesday, but there's some more, the 30-day map challenge, Makeover Monday, all on my GitHub, as mentioned, also on many more other GitHubs. So check out those repositories of people contributing to Tidy Tuesday. There are many, many more. I think there were 2,000 repositories named Tidy Tuesday. So many codes to check out, including forks, I guess. So there you will find on my page, for example, but also on others, many, many, many plots for the last years. And also I sent you the link for the repository for the Outlier conference, where you will find the hands-on tutorial and also the codes to produce the Penguin plots, at least here. And you will also find the recording from the short version, and the new slides from today are also already uploaded. And with this, I want to thank you. No. This one, but this I want to thank you. These are two of my more visited blog posts. So there's one very long ggplot tutorial on how to change basically everything, like colors of your access labels or how to do a pie chart. And this was one of my first blog posts about how I turn the gray default box plot into a colorful distribution dot plot for Tidy Tuesday. With this, thank you very much.